Welcome back to a new episode in the series of Cultural Dimensions. First, I would like to present a new way on how you can be a part in this series. If you want to be named with your YouTube nickname in the next video or your country of heritage, as a fitting example, you will have to do the following. Guess the top 6 examples for each cultural dimension. Choose wisely for which end of the scale you are participating, because you can only guess one side. So please state in the comments or via a channel message which end of the scale you have chosen, your 6 countries, and if you want your name to be shown or your country as an example. You can participate until the new video is produced, which usually takes 4 weeks. The first 5 participants for each language who got it all right will be picked. So good luck to you and have a ball guessing! Today's episode will shed light onto the theory of Gerd Hofstede, which is one of the best known theory concerning cultural dimensions. Due to the sheer amount of information, I'm forced to divide the content into 2 videos. Gerard Hendrik Hofstede is a Dutch social psychologist and a former IBM employee. He's professor emeritus of organizational anthropology and international management at Maastricht University. He received his school diploma in 1945 and graduated at Delft Technical University in 1953 as Master of Science in Mechanical Engineering. In addition, in 1967 he achieved the PhD in Social Psychology. He joined IBM International as a management trainer and manager of personal research in 1965 and found the personal research department. Between 1971 and 1973, he was a visiting lecturer at the International Institute of Management Development, IMEDI. In 1980, he co-founded and became the director of the International Institute for Research on Intercultural Cooperation. He became a knight in the Order of the Netherlands Lion in 2011. While working at IBM, he had the chance to conduct an employee opinion survey at over 17 national subsidiaries. The survey's content was in regard of people's behavior in large organizations and how they collaborate. It contained over 100,000 subjects, had been translated into 18 languages, but the USA wasn't included due to the IBM history regarding internal surveys. During his time at IBM, he hasn't had the time to look into the data the research brought to light. Only in 1971, during a break from IBM, he was able to process the data via factor and correlation analysis. At IMEDI, he also conducted a survey with 362 managers from 30 different countries and compared it to the data acquired through the IBM survey. His conclusion was published in 1980 in Culture's Consequences, International Differences in Work-Related Values. Later, in 2002, he published another book called Culture's Consequences, Comparing Values, Behaviors, Institutions and Organizations Across Nations, where he addressed the critique for his first work, but more about that critique later on. If you read Gerd Hofstede's book publication of 1980, you will have to deal with his definition of things relating mental programs, values and culture. Mental programs can be found in a universal collective and at an individual level, while values are defined as values as a desired and values as a desirable. Culture, on the other hand, is a collective programming of the mind and is describing entire societies, while groups within that culture are called subcultures. Now we will talk about what mental programs are ought to be. It is a social system that only exists in human behavior. It is not random and to some extent predictable. Each prediction contains information about the person and the context, while mental programming is stable over time. These programs can't be observed directly. They are inherited, transferred via genes, and can be also learned after birth. Hofstede differentiates 3 levels of mental programming: universal, collective and individual. The universal level is shared by all mankind, is a biological operating system which contains basic behaviors and is inherited. The collective level is common to people of a certain group or category. is an area of subjective human culture, language, behaviors in the group, traditions, and is learned. The individual level is unique. There's no other like. It contains alternative behaviors within the same collective culture and is partly inherited. Societies, organizations, and groups have a way of conserving and passing on metal programs from generation to generation with obstinacy. Values in that relation have a broad tendency to prefer certain states of affairs over others and are non-rational but can seem rational. They are mutually related to the individual and its forms of value systems and hierarchies. They have a certain intensity and direction, mustn't be in harmony, and can support contrary views like freedom and equality. A distinction is made between what is actually desired and what is ought to be desired. In terms of norms of values, we speak of collectivity when values are held by the majority. Culture is a collective programming of the mind which distinguishes the members of one human group from another, and it includes system of values. Culture is to collectivity what personality is to an individual. It determines the identity of a human group and interacts with the individual. Cultural patterns are homeostatic, self-regulating, and in a quasi-equilibrium, which is implied in the stabilizing of culture patterns by Hofstede. Let me explain how Hofstede sees these stabilizing factors. The outside influences, like the forces of nature or man, have an impact on the origin of that particular culture. It shapes its demographic, history, technology, and economy, depending on which local resources are available. This will have an influence on the societal norms that ought to be formed in that society, for example, not to trust a stranger right away, and this will have an impact on the structure of these groups. The consequences of that are distinct family patterns, role differentiation, different religions, or a certain political structure. These resulting outcomes, on the other hand, reinforce the origin and the societal norms and therefore achieve or create an equilibrium. Hofstede differentiates between six different dimensions. Number 1. Power distance. Number 2. Uncertainty avoidance. Number 3. Individualism versus collectivism. Number 4. Masculinity versus femininity. Number 5. Indulgence versus restraint. Number 6. Long versus short-term orientation. Before we define any dimension, I would like to address that I only will speak about 3 to 4 samples for every end of the scale for the above named dimensions. You can find more examples in the books, internet page of Gerd Hofstede, or in the text I created. The term power distance was first described in the Daily Power Game by the Dutch social psychologist Mark Mulder in the 1960s and refers to interpersonal power differences. According to Mulder's power distance reduction theory, subordinates will try to reduce the power distance while the elite ought to maintain and enlarge it. Hofstede understands it as the level of power distance at which both tendency we find the equilibrium which is determined by society. Differences occur due to intellectual and physical skills in the group or are predetermined by birth. In the 1970s, Hofstede applied these differences onto national societies and created his definition. It is the extent to which the less powerful members of institutions and organizations expect and accept that power is distributed unequally. How much weight is put on to status consistency depends on the perception of how prestige, wealth, and power could occur and how the inequality of its distribution is perceived in the society. To compare these differences, Hofstede created a power distance index, PDI, which is scaled 0 for lower scores and 100 for larger scores. The positions of societies are expressed in relation to each other, and therefore it is measuring the differences between national societies. In societies with more power distance, people are convinced that inequality should be minimized, that hierarchy represents an inequality of roles and is only established as convenience for the power holders. All members shall have equal rights and the use of power should be legitimate. An example for that is the cooperative style in corporations, which leads to delegation and equality, and title formality isn't important. Countries with low power distance are, for example, Britain and Germany, with a score of 35. Societies with high power distance believe there ought to be an order of inequality and everyone has its rightful place. High and low power holders are protected by that hierarchy and she is existential for the inequality. The ones who inherit power are entitled to privileges and the legitimacy of power is irrelevant. As an example, you can take the directive style in corporation, which leads to guidance, direction, and leaders are highly respected. Country examples are Mexico with a score of 81 and China with 80. For low PDI countries, this has the consequence that there is a separation of power, the political system changed by evolution, and less centralization is ought to be achieved. High PDI countries have dictatorships and oligarchies, the political system is changed by revolution and more centralization is the goal. These scores are based on values and transferred from parents to children and are rarely changed. Sjoerd Boekelsteeg assumes there is a worldwide power shift to smaller power distances, but the relative position of all countries on the scoreboard remained the same, because the differences in between nations are rooted in history. Uncertainty avoidance has its origins in the behavior theory of the firm of Richard Syed and James March from 1963, which was applied to the level of organizations. Hofstede describes once again the differences between national societies and understands it as he extends to which members of a culture feel threatened by ambiguous or unknown situations. Extreme uncertainty creates intolerable anxiety, and human society has developed ways to cope with the inherent uncertainty of our living on the brink of an uncertain future. These ways belong to the domains of technology, law, and religion. Of utmost importance is that there isn't risk avoidance in general. It only refers to that risks are taken when they represent a known variable. The Uncertainty Avoidance Index UAI is also scaled from 0 for low and 100 for high avoidance. As for the PDI, the interrelated position for every society is represented by the scores. In uncertainty accepting societies, people have lower stress and anxiety levels, have a stronger achievement motivation, therefore hope of success, and people are willing to break rules for pragmatic reasons. That means as well that rules are taken more in an informal way and there's reluctance in obeying them in general. Good examples are higher investments in risky ventures, a higher number of corporation establishments, because in these societies there are less rules and therefore it is easier and faster to establish a corp. Country examples for this kind of trade are China with a score of 30 and Britain with a score of 35. In uncertainty-avoiding societies, people in general have a higher stress and anxiety level, less achievement motivation, therefore fear of failure, rules shouldn't be broken, and people feel a need for rules. Examples here are lower investments in general, even in secure ventures, a low number of corporation establishments, because these societies tend to have more rules and therefore it is harder and slower to establish a corp. Societies are, for example, Japan with a score of 92 and France with 86. Consequences for low UAI countries are that there is a weak nationalism, more religious tolerance, and pragmatic thinking is popular. High UAI countries, on the other hand, have a strong nationalism, an intolerant state religion, and ideological thinking is more popular. These scores are also based on values inherited from parents and rarely change. There is, as Boykostig predicted, a worldwide shift towards lower scores. In addition, the national stress levels oscillate with a wavelength of 25 to 30 years, which means every 3 decades a nation hits a high level of stress due to context factors. Aside from that, the scores are stable. The terms individualism and collectivism have been used for the first time in the 19th century to represent political ideologies and are strongly value-related. In the 1920s, they are presented as being opposites and emerge in the 1960s in personality psychology as individualism but not collectivism. Hofstede defines individualism as a society where ties between individuals are loose, everyone expected to look after themselves and their immediate family. Collectivism is defined as a society where individuals from birth onwards are part of a strong in-group. The term in-group refers to a social group to which a person feels to be a member of. With an out-group, that person doesn't identify itself. Individualism is negatively correlated to power distance, which means that high scores on individualism are related to low scores on power distance and vice versa. Hierarchies correlate positive with collectivism and power distance, while individualism is negatively correlated because in groups there's usually a leader who leads its members and a hierarchy is established that way. In addition, individualism is positively correlated with wealth and the PDI is negatively correlated with it. But if you compare rich with rich countries and poor with poor, this correlation disappears. The individualism index score, IDV, is also scaled from 0 for low and 100 for high individualism. The position of a particular nation is represented by its relative position to the other societies. In societies with a low individualism score, there is a predominant we consciousness that leads to a collectivity orientation of its people. There is also exclusionism, which is the classification of others into in or out groups, and relations are more important than tasks. The people of Japan, for example, prefer maiden nippon, usually eat together with their families, and group goals are always utmost important. Country examples with low IDV scores are Mexico with 30 and 38 for Arabic countries. Societies with a high IDV score, on the other hand, inherit an I consciousness, therefore a self-orientation. They classify others as individuals and tasks are more important than relations. An example are the people from the United States who only prefer made in USA when the quality is better. They see eating as the greatest pleasure of all, and personal accomplishments are important. Represents are Australia with a score of 90 and Britain with a score of 89. The low IDV score countries are living in a community-based social order. Their political power system is more unbalanced and human rights are less respected. High IDV countries live in a society-based social order, they have an overall balanced power political system, and human rights are more respected. Individualism is also transferred from generation to generation. The position due to comparison between countries stays the same, and differences are also rooted in the history of each country, so you may claim that it is stable over time. That's all for today. I wish you a nice day. Thanks for watching, and until the second video here on iCat, ciao ciao!